go that time.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Sure. Way down, way down.
I blaze the river where old mill run. Meet the lazy river with the noonday sun. Linger in the shade of a kind old tree.
Grow away your trouble. Boogie B. Carmichael used to be a rod maker, and I wrote a book that I probably shouldn't have written, called The Master's Guide to Building a Bamboo Fly Rod with Everett Garrison, and I'm happy to say it's in its eighth printing. So I've been around this stuff since 1969, which is when I met Everett, and it's been a part of me ever since. I was up at the Tuscarora Club, which is in the Catskills, a marvelous little river called, a private club called Millbrook. And I had my fiberglass carrot-looking 7.5-footer out on the lawn with a spanking new Pfluger Medalist reel. And I was casting back and forth, and so were some other people. And I thought, I mean, I know they're going to come over and look at this thing, because this is, I mean... But no, they were over there somewhere with this older gentleman, gray-haired guy, who had bamboo. I never actually had a bamboo rod in my hand, I don't think. And it was Mr. Garrison. And so I knew enough to tuck my little rod and reel away and go see what the clamor was about. And of course, in the afternoon, I started talking to him, and I asked him quickly, I mean, do you make them? And he said, yeah. And he said, I hand plane them. And I thought, yeah, right. He gets these corners. This is so tight. All this beautiful. He does it all himself with planes. I don't think so. And that's what got my curiosity going, really. And then I got to know him, and he got to trusting me, and changed my life. I went to his shop by invitation because he was not anybody who liked to have people down there. He wasn't looking for help, I can tell you that. I think it was 1970. And it was in Ossining, New York, Piping Rock Drive. And I knew I was walking into this... although it was in the basement, there was a washing machine over there and stuff. But Gary had his area, his spot, with a whole bunch of tools that I had never operated, never put my hand on, didn't know what they were. But I knew I wanted to be there. And he started to show me around, you know. And then as it progressed, I think it was 1972-3, I made a film about him, called Creating the Garrison Fly Rod, nice catchy title, and the film was a great education for me, and I loved doing it for him. Every time he saw the film, the same film, he, when the lights went up, he said, oh, Hoagie, I like that version better, because he had just seen some things that he hadn't seen before, you know. Mr. Garrison was very patient with me, because I was a city boy who could do some things, but I didn't know how to turn a lathe on. You know, I really didn't. And we had sessions together, none of which were, you know, a weekend session, because I lived in New York or I lived in Pittsburgh. And so I would fly in really just for a day and spend some time. But he was wonderful.
The strip only will be cut.
He was great. There's nothing he wouldn't show me. Nothing at all. And much of what I learned by going step by step by step by step with the film. And I would ask him questions there, and I'd put that in my little noggin and say, okay, now I get that, you know, I understand. Because he went through the whole process. It was one morning I remember very well. I was over there and I said, Gary, we should put this stuff between pages. I'd never written anything to speak of. I mean, you know, the way everybody else does. But I thought, well, this, I should do this, you know. Can I, will you do it with me? Oh yes, he'd like to do that. So I started notes and all of that, and then he got sick. I mean, he really got sick. And I was up making a little film for Fred Rogers up in Massachusetts about light chip baskets, I think, and I got a call, and he had, Dr. Trotter couldn't bring him around. So I thought, whoa, I've made this promise, and he has told me face-to-face that I could do a chapter on his tapering. Very important, very unusual, but I didn't know anything about that. His lab, all the stuff that was around in that basement, those were my notes, you know. And I was able to, some would say successfully, get it all between those covers. And then people could pick and choose, you know. You don't want to make your own varnishing tanks? Fine. You don't want to do that? That's fine. But this is the way he did it. And it's worked out. A lot of people have made rods. So when Mr. Garrison died, I was the, I guess, obvious heir apparent. And I wasn't given the shop. I bought it. I didn't pay a lot of money for it. I paid what they wanted, which is about all I had. In any case, I did buy the shop. And I made a couple of rods out of his basement. I used to go over there and, you know, Mrs. Garrison would feed me and make a few. And then I moved everything to a small little area, a chop area, in Katona, New York, off Todd Road. In fact, I had the gluing binder set up, and when I glued rods, I had a hole in the wall that I put in, and the rods would go into the furnace room. Yeah, and when I made five 7-footers in that. Boy, I wish I had one. 5 7-footers in that room, and believe me, I had windows open, doors open, the thing going into the, you know. So, and then it was there, and then I built a shop over in Bedford. I built that building with Billy Herrick, and we worked hard, and it happened to be it was a little, I don't know, beekeeper's thing or something. There was a furnace in there, and they let me build this shop, and I made a lot of good runs. Rods, good rods, maybe, in that shop. And then I moved it to this shop here, and I've been in here 20 years. So he owned the rod shop for 43 years, and I owned it for 39 years. This is a little hard to explain, but about 1990, I moved here, and I was starting to do some other things, trying to work on some things. My father had died. I wanted to work on his catalog. I had an idea for a show. I did a tour all over the country. I was doing a lot of other things, and my time in this shop was abbreviated. And I am just, it's a fact, I am not a guy who could come in here for 4 hours on a Saturday and make it rods. I need to go. It takes me 4 hours to get everything just the way I want it. Go. And I mean, I used to make rods till 11 o'clock at night. I was planing and so happy. God. So I could see my interest, not in the craft, but my own personal interest. It didn't fall off the shelf, but it was going. And then I made a rod and it wasn't a very good one, relative to what I thought my standards were. And I've said this to you, and I've said this to a lot of people. If you can put your name on it, it's got to be the best you can do, you know? And my father taught me that. Mr. Garrison, I know, felt the same way. So I saw my skills, believe it or not, slipping. And when they started to slip, I started to do more repair work and real work, and I could make things on the lathe. But I could see the time coming when, one, I wasn't driven by it, and two, probably wasn't as good at it, you know? So I began to talk to the Catskill Museum about taking this shop over. They have a marvelous thing in the fall called the Rodmakers Gathering, and it's a series. They built a huge building, and the idea it always was, I won't say that, but I think the idea was that this shop could be in that area as an exhibit, partial exhibit, and to use portions of the shop to make, to teach people, to you know, that's very important. So we made a deal, and last August, just a couple of months ago, this huge truck came, and it was hard. It was really hard. It's actually still not easy. I walk into this room and all this stuff that I spent my life with, half of my life with, maybe 39 years, yes, it's gone, you know. The bench that sat right there, I wrote the book on. I made all of my rods on. Mr. Garrison made all of his rods on. I repaired zumpteen reels, you know. A lot of stuff right there, but it's not here anymore.
The lazy river where the old mill run meets lazy, lazy river in a noonday sun.
Now, everything has been moved from this shop to the Catskill Fly Fishing Center and Museum up in Roscoe Livingston Manor, and I'm very, very pleased about that because, well, it's where it belongs. People will get to see it, people get to touch it. People are actually having their photograph taken with it. But I think people can learn from all of those tools that are there, and I know they're going to set up a portion, which is very much what I wanted, for people to use the tools hands-on, run the lathe, make a piece that's just like this piece and all of that. And that's the object, to keep this craft going. That's the right home. And that's where all my shop and Mr. Garrison's shop lives. And I'm pleased.
They're in the shade of a kind old tree. Throw away your troubles, dream a dream with me. Up a lazy river where the robin's song awakes the bright new morning, we can loaf along. Blue skies up above, everyone's in love. Up a lazy river, how happy you will be. Up a lazy river with me.